housewives, they don't gotta muffle their shit, too. They don't gotta worry about the velocity with which their doo-doo comes out. A lot of my friends, when we walk around together, they'll get very judgmental about housewives that we'll see on the street. And they'll be like, look at that fucking housewife not doing anything. Look at that housewife just walking around all day, getting massages in her Lululemon pants. I'm like, that bitch is a genius. She's not a housewife, she's retired. I do write for Fresh Off the Boat on ABC. Yeah, which is, it's a great show. I love it a lot. I love my coworkers. It's a great writing staff. And in terms of day jobs, it's probably one of the best you could ask for. But I still gotta work at an office every day, which means I gotta shit in an office every day. Housewives, they don't gotta shit in an office. Housewives get to shit in their house, skin to seat. They don't gotta use that horrible toilet paper cover. They don't gotta 10 times a day, every day. Like you're about to eat a sad ass meal. They don't gotta do that. They don't gotta use that one-ply toilet paper, that office toilet paper that they purposely make difficult to pull out. They're trying to ration me with their communist toilet paper. That's not even effective. It basically just dehydrates your butthole. It's basically like wiping your butt with the desert. I literally spat on my toilet paper 2 days ago to try to make a MacGyver baby wipe to moisten it, and then it backfired because my fingers broke through and digitally stimulated more doo-doo to come out, and then I had to start all over again. And you can never finish wiping at work because you always feel rushed because you're paranoid that your coworker's gonna recognize your shoes underneath the stall, and you're like, oh no, Courtney's listening, she's waiting, she's timing me, and then you hurry, 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 and then you never finish wiping, and then your butthole feels caked in doo-doo all day long, and then if you dare scratch yourself, your underwear at the end of the day looks like it's been run over by the Goonies. Housewives, they don't gotta muffle their shit, too. They don't gotta worry about the velocity with which their doo-doo comes out. They don't gotta try to, you know, squeeze the butt cheeks together to make sure that the doo-doo comes out at a slow and steady pace so that no unpredictable noise suddenly escapes and brings you deep, deep shame. Housewives are free to just blow ass into the toilet and let it echo and reverberate to the ends of their hallways while watching as much Netflix on their iPad as they want. They don't gotta take these boring, repressed shits. They can listen to podcasts, Planet Money. They could do whatever they want. You know, it's very distracting for me when I hear my coworkers blow ass into the toilet. I lose respect for them. Nothing they say to me anymore holds any sort of credence. I heard one of my coworkers blow ass into the toilet the other day. This bitch had the nerve to come up to me and say, "You need to get to work on time." I was like, "You need to eat bananas." I saw those green ballet flats. I know that shit was you. Don't try to tell me to get my shit together when I heard you not have your shit together.
I'm gonna tell you one more story. It's about my dad. Look, I know that I've made jokes about him, and the reality is I love him dearly, and I never take for granted how lucky I am to get to spend that time traveling around the world with him. And I'm so proud of him as well for how much he puts himself out of his comfort zone to do the stuff that we do. And I get to see whole new sides to my dad that I never thought that I would see. And that's not to say that on occasion I haven't pushed him too far. And so I want to leave you with this story about the occasion when I did just that. And it was actually very traumatic at the time. It was something that we didn't feel like we could put in the show because it wound up with him collapsing and being rushed to hospital. But tragedy plus time equals comedy. So here goes. It happened when we went to the Ukraine and we visited Chernobyl. Has anyone ever been to Chernobyl, by the way? Woo! Just that woman over there. Holding up her third hand. It's a terrifying place. It's a terrifying place. The site of the worst ever nuclear disaster in human history. Uninhabited now, other than by packs of feral stray dogs. But weirdly, also, now a tourist destination. Fun for all the family. They got a gift shop in Chernobyl. They got a canteen in Chernobyl. A canteen in Chernobyl, which no one in their right mind would eat in. Unfortunately, my father, not in his right mind. We went in there. It was full of Japanese tourists. Eventually, I get to the front of the queue. I was like, so, what's on the menu today? Meat in bun. Thank you, madam. What's the vegetarian option? You take the meat out of the bun. 100 times I told Daddy, do not eat the meat in a bun. Did he listen? Did he fuck? He was like, I've eaten lunch every day at 1 p.m. for my entire life. Today will be no exception. Go find me a wine list. A wine list? Daddy, we're in a canteen in Chernobyl. There is no wine list. Even if there was, I don't think it's one you'd want to go anywhere near. Would sir like the red, white, or glow in the dark? Red, please. Could you suggest a good year? Anything before 1986. I was like, Daddy, you're not having any wine. Just have a glass of water. He went, I don't drink water. Why? Because fish fuck in it. So he doesn't drink any water. He eats the mystery meat in a bun. Cut to 45 minutes later, we are in a van. We are with our camera crew. We are driving past the exclusion zone towards Pripyat into the deserted woodlands, the most toxic and radioactive place on Earth. When all of a sudden, my father turns to me and whispers in my ear, Jack, I need the toilet. I turn to look at him and he does not look in a good way. Seriously, I have not seen him this red in the face since I told him there was a Women's World Cup. I'm like, Daddy, you can't go to the toilet. You missed your chance. We are now in the middle of buttfuck nowhere. He grabbed my arm, and in a voice that sounded like he had been possessed by a demon, he goes, stop this van! I've never seen my dad partake in physical exercise in his entire life. He literally ripped open the door to this van and he ran into the woods like he was Usain fucking Bolt. I turn to the camera crew. I'm like, just hide behind the van. I will go and I will deal with this. I follow my father into the woods, past these signs, danger, do not trespass, radiation. You're constantly told when you're in Chernobyl that you cannot touch or lean on any surface for fear of radiation poisoning. Therefore, as I enter the woods, it becomes very clear very quickly that the only way that my 79-year-old father is going to be able to relieve himself in the woods is with my assistance. Oh, you may grimace. I had to live through this experience. My father pulls down the trousers of his three-piece suit. I take him in both hands. I tread on the tops of his feet, and at the same time, we both start to slowly lean back like we're doing some horrible tantric yoga pose. I can't look at him. I have to go to a happy place. I start humming a tune. I'm broken from my happy place by the sound of barking. I open my eyes. One of these feral radioactive dogs is advancing towards my father's arse, thinking, lunchtime. I'm trying to scare this thing away. I'm like, shoo, shoo, please just leave us alone. My dad shouting as well, this is so fucking undignified. I think it's when the coachload of Japanese tourists drove past that I must have gone into a fugue state. That is not a side of my father that I want to see. The next thing that I remember is coming to, walking towards this van, thinking I'm never going to be able to look Daddy in the eye ever again. I call the camera crew out from their hiding place. First comes our director, then our cameraman. The third person to emerge was Mark, our sound engineer. He also had a haunted look on his face. It's at that point that I realized that throughout the entire ordeal in the woods, we had been wearing microphones. Then, as if it couldn't get any worse, the crunch of tires on gravel, an armored vehicle pulls up. And from that armored vehicle emerge three armed members of the Ukrainian military police. They assess the scene. They see my father's ashen face. They see the signs that we have completely ignored. And they see the site of Chernobyl's second worst ever nuclear fallout. They do not look best pleased. It's at that point that I think quickly and I intervene. I'm like, gentlemen, before you say anything, can I just point out that I have read all of the signs here and nowhere can I see one that says, would you please refrain from entering the woods with active diarrhea?
And husband, he's so sweet. You know, obviously this is his first time, so it's very nice. I remember the first time I left for work, he's like, okay, so I guess I'm on daddy duty right now. I was like, for all of time. Look at this time. Look at this time. Look at all of time, motherfucker, daddy duty. All the time. Daddy duty all the time. It doesn't stop. He's so well-meaning. He's never taken care of a baby before. Now we got twins, okay? He's never even changed a diaper. I said, oh, you are not Caribbean. That's some shit. I was teaching him how to change a diaper. I was like, it's like an orthopedic shoe, okay? He zips it. But he didn't realize babies have these things called blowouts. And it's not when they straighten their hair. It's when they shit up their back to their necks. Yeah. And he was changing a baby and had blowout and it kept shitting. And oh my God, my husband shut down like a host in Westworld. He's like, but there's so much. Held that so long. Yeah, it was so long. I was thinking about what I wanted to eat later.